How do? Pete Donaldson here on Absolute Radio. I'm joined by Liam from the Cortinas.
Hello, mate.
Yeah, man, how are you doing?
Good, how are you?
Good, good. You're wearing very white clothing. You don't want to get splashed by any kind of dirty puddle.
It's weird on this because it's white and cream, but I'm reliably informed that's all right, white and cream.
That's okay, isn't it? Yeah.
I wouldn't have thought so, but you know what? I mean, what do I know? But here we are.
Fantastic stuff. How have the last few months gone for you? Because obviously, the last time I spoke to you, I think, was at the We Are Manchester concert. Mm-hmm. I was stood next to Noel Gallagher watching the Cortinas do their thing to a raucous Manchester crowd. I thought, this is the most Manchester thing I could possibly be doing. If I was drinking a glass of Vimto, that would be the only thing that could top it.
Eccles cake in one hand, yeah, Vimto definitely. In the other. It was a weird night, but it was like, obviously, with everything around it, but I think that we did a good job, if that's possible, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, well, I think it was...
You know, that everybody there was there for the same thing, I guess, to try and, you know, make sure we all had a good night.
Yeah.
And remember those that weren't there, I suppose. Mm. So, yeah. It's been a tough time, I guess, for the city. I think it's still in shock.
Well, I guess the big news from the Cortinas camp, apart from the Teenage Cancer Trust, is going to be playing very soon. It's the re-release of your debut album. Mm. Not even the re-release, to be honest. It's a reimagining. Redux.
I'm just trying to make a bit of coin.
So you've gone back and you've looked at the debut album and you've kind of rejigged it, rearranged it.
Just made it well better.
Yeah.
No, I think I did some acoustic dates at the end of last year. Mm. And I just went out, just me and our piano player, Adam.
Yeah.
And we've always done them as B-sides, a few acoustic versions and stuff, and the fans seem to like them. Mm. So I wonder if we'd do the whole album like this. And we went in, we thought it was going to take about 3 days, and it ended up taking about 3 months.
Right.
So, but but it sounds great, and we've reimagined some of them. And I mean, still, it's a strange album, because, I mean, when we were doing it, we didn't think anybody would still be listening to it 10 years later, so... This is going to sound bad, but there wasn't that much thought put into it.
Well, some
debuts, you listen to it and they're so well... It's like they've spent the whole life... Like, I spent like the whole month before we went in to record it. What should we do for it? I mean, to be honest, we were... Everything like leading up to recording our debut album, we were just gigging. And we really wanted that kind of live sound, so it's very raw and very visceral. But the meaning behind the songs, I mean, it's just us growing up and a snapshot of where you are when you're 19, 20,
yeah.
I guess.
Yeah.
So, and the beauty of it is, now at the gigs, there's definitely, I was going to say a new generation, but we've almost had that twice. Mm. You know where the front row is like 15, 16, 17.
Yeah.
That front suede of the crowd is still that age, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Whereas... We're in our 30s now.
So to speak. But it is that thing where you start going to gigs when you're about 18 or, you know, obviously even earlier than that. And you're like, I'm never going to be the guy that stands at the back. And then about 3 years later, you're the guy that stands at the back.
Yeah, I know. And I can see my friends getting further and further back. Can you hear us? Does it sound all right?
I imagine they get better looking then as they go further back as we get older.
The darker it gets.
But it must be quite... I suppose cathartic, kind of going back and listening and kind of filleting the best moments from the album. Sort of go. It must give you a new respect for what you wrote all those years ago.
Yeah, it's strange because I'm like this pessimistic indie kid.
Yeah.
That's like, stop patting yourself on the back.
Yeah.
Come on, get on with the next thing. And I hate that kind of self-congratulatory. But then here we are doing interviews for it, patting ourselves on the back. So I can't hate it that much.
Yeah,
we did a piece for a respectable music magazine the other day. It started off a bit like, we're going to all our, you know, old haunts, as it were.
Okay.
And it started off like we were, not didn't want to be there, but almost embarrassed, I guess.
Right, okay.
And by the end of it, it was like, what a fucking great day we had, you know? It was just talking about how it all began and stuff like that. And we've never really done that as a band. We've never really had... the time off to kind of reflect on it all.
Right.
So, I mean, if you're not going to do it at 10 years, you're probably never going to do it.
Yeah.
So I thought, why not, you know?
Isn't that half the struggle, though, just being comfortable with your own legacy? Isn't that what the tortured artist is all about?
We're lucky that it's continued to kind of grow slowly but surely each year. It's not like we came out with this bang and then it all died off.
Mm.
I think if that would have happened, this would feel like not necessarily lap of honour, but like it would be like, right, that might be it kind of thing. But because it's still on the, it's still growing for us. It feels like we're still reaching new people.
Yeah.
And new people are still getting that first album.
Yeah.
I suppose that's the beauty of like streaming, I suppose, to a certain extent, that people can just go and listen to the back catalogue and go, oh, all right, I've got some other songs.
But this is kind of like at the start of, you know, Game of Thrones Series 4, they do a little recap of the last season.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
this is
yeah.
kind of like that in many ways.
Yeah, it's a little rewind.
I read that you were like part of the releases for Record Store Day. You put out a vinyl version of one of the singles or the album itself for Record Store Day.
Yeah, I think so. It's that much stuff coming out. I don't even know anymore.
So many formats.
Just what? Cassette?
Yeah.
Stick it out.
Are you doing and, cassettes again?
Is that yeah, the, but then, is that thing? Then comes the, yeah, you said you'd sign them.
Right.
I was like, what? So we've done like, I think we've done about 12,000 pre-orders, which,
holy moly.
Which sounds great. It's a guaranteed top 10. So someone says, the boxes are there.
Right, okay.
It takes about a week.
Yeah, okay, I understand.
So there's going to be a lot of that.
Have you simplified your signature somewhat since
See,
you started?
I haven't.
Right.
Other members of the band, however.
They've started just using initials and things like that.
Sellouts.
There was that amazing story of Paul Gascoigne got taken into a room and he had to sign all his footballs around about Italia 90. And every footballer in the England squad had to do it. And so everyone took ages and they were just like bored by the end of it. Like, Paul, how did you finish yours so quickly? And it turns out he just filled a room full of footballs, just writing the word Pele. He'd signed them as Pele instead. What was the first kind of vinyl release that you bought back in the day? I know it's a bit of a classic kind of question, but what was your first record?
When me and Conan were in probably year 9 at school, we were about 13, 14, we started collecting all the Oasis singles on CD.
Oh, right, okay, yeah.
But they're like EPs, you got 4 tracks on
yeah,
them.
Yeah, that's
so
right,
like,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
£4 for. It's like, that's amazing.
Great value.
So we went back in and did all the CDs. And I think probably, I'm not like trying to be cool or anything, because that obviously wouldn't happen. But I think...
not with White and Cream.
I think Made of Stone on 7-inch.
Right.
Or maybe Made of Stone, one of the Roses ones, because when we're in Vinyl Exchange, you know, that was the next step when you're 13, 14.
Yeah,
you
yeah,
see
yeah.
Oasis.
I'm a real connoisseur now.
And then you
I'm
see,
audio
oh,
file.
The Stone Roses. Yeah, I'll have some of that as well. Just to be typically Mancunian. But the first album I got on vinyl, I think was by The Kills, Keep On Your Mean Side.
Oh, nice.
Really bluesy,
yeah,
garage rock thing. Still one of my favourite bands. So yeah, that, I think that was the first album I got on vinyl.
Well, we're speaking of sort of growing up and buying records and becoming a rock and roll band. Blossoms were in a couple of weeks ago.
The boys.
In this very seat.
And
were they
wearing White and Cream?
They were wearing White and Cream.
They dress well though, don't they?
They do dress well. It's increasingly harder to interview them because they seem to have more members every time I sort of sit down with them. But you've spoken quite eloquently about how you see a little bit of yourself in them or them in you, so to speak, because you've seen them kind of grow to a meteoric, at a meteoric rate in many ways. You must love those guys, surely.
Yeah, they're great. They have to watch going on nights out with us though, because I don't think they're quite there yet.
No, they're not there.
Yeah. But we had, I remember watching them in a place in Manchester called Sound Control. Mm. I think has gone to the developers now, like a few places. Yeah. But I mean, it was a small gig, but it was still packed and you could still feel it in there. You know, when you're watching a band and there's just a bit of word going around town about them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So the people that are there.
The queue's just
like,
that little bit longer. The people
like,
are a little bit cooler.
Oh, he's here. So they must, and she's here. And I see them quite a lot. So they must be happening.
Right.
And you could tell that they thought that on the stage.
Right.
And that's such an exciting, you know, when the band starts to go, yeah, there might be something here now.
Yeah.
So that was, and then obviously from there to, you know, Castlefield Bowl and which is about 8,000 and Glastonbury and stuff, smashing it, and they're good, but they believe it, but they're not necessarily arrogant with it, you know.
No, God,
good chaps.
Yeah, they're thoroughly pleasant as well. Have you got any advice? Did you give them any advice when you were sort of taking them out on nights out and stuff like that? Apart from pace yourself and drink.
They've probably forgotten it all. They've obviously not listened because they're doing really well.
Good news. You're going to be doing the Teenage Cancer Trust gig, obviously, very soon indeed. I mean, that's got to be an important cause for you.
Yeah. We supported Noel for it 7-8 years ago. And it always gets a great calibre of guest. Mm. And there's just like so many people within the organization that do so much to make the small things, I guess, like that a little bit easier for people who are going through that awful, awful time. So yeah, if we can help in any way by playing a show, absolutely, we'll be there.
Definitely. And second billing on the opening night of Leeds as well.
Yeah.
That's not bad, is it?
That's all right.
That's
all right for us. It's all right. Yeah, I think we're under the King of Leon.
Yeah.
I mean. Easy. You know. We'll deal with them. Yeah.
And obviously we're recording this on a Wednesday, and I think it's a Wednesday, isn't it? I do lose track of time sometimes, I mean. The night after Manchester United went out of the Champions League,
yeah.
A bit of a whimper, to be honest. What's going on with that team?
Well, it's one step forward. There's a lot of sniggers from behind. One step forward and about six back, it seems, at the minute.
It was a great performance at the weekend, and then just...
Yeah, and I don't know, it was all right, and we won. So I think Scholesy might have said last night, like, you get away with it if you win.
Yeah.
And you don't play great, because people kind of forget about it after a week or so. But there was zero intent. And I think the strangest thing is, you want to level some criticism at Mourinho, because he's obviously setting his team out to be defensive.
Yeah.
And boring. It's awful to watch.
It's really awful.
It really is. But then you've got a £90 million player in Paul Pogba, just you can't pass a ball 15 yards. Where's your head at? Does he not want to be there?
Well, it's sort of body language. When he's not interested, he looks like
Sanchez, this world beater that we got from Arsenal. Not seen him yet.
No.
A lot
of individuals in that team.
Yeah, something. Oh, thank God for David De Gea, because we'd probably be relegated. So something's going on there, but God knows what it is. Perhaps I need to change the caterers or something, I don't know.
Dodgy lasagna, that's a situation.
Something's going wrong.
Well, mate, thank you so much for joining us again. We'll no doubt speak to you sooner rather than later. Go and pick up the reimagining of the debut Cortina's album, and we'll speak to you very soon.
Thanks, mate.